practicing the biblical principles of what a church should be and manifesting the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the Hour of Faith, originating from the sanctuary of Faith Baptist Church, Altoona, Pennsylvania, 315 40th Street in the Highland Park section of the city. As you participate in today's broadcast, may the Lord challenge your heart with the Word.
And we do want to welcome those of you joining us by radio and television to the Sunday morning service coming to you from the Faith Baptist Church of Altoona, Pennsylvania, the United States of America. And wherever you might be today, we do thank you very, very much for the pleasure of your company. And if we can never serve you spiritually, please don't hesitate to contact us. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, we would love to lead you to Christ. If you do know the Lord Jesus Christ, we would love to help you in your walk with Christ on a day-by-day basis. We'd also invite you to visit us here. If you're in central Pennsylvania, you can drop by. We are located at 315 40th Street in the Highland Park section of the city of Altoona, where we have Sunday school every Sunday morning at 9:30, classes for all ages, morning service at 10:30, and our evening service at 6 o'clock. And you are invited to be with us. We want to remind you that coming up July the 31st through August the 5th is the Central Pennsylvania Bible Conference. Now, that's not a ministry of Faith Baptist, but it is a ministry of our sister ministry, the Way of Truth Ministries. However, the Bible Conference goes back to 1920. This is the 97th annual Bible Conference for Central Pennsylvania. Over the years, some of the greatest preachers and teachers of the country have been here. And this year, we've got, again, two great preachers, David Kistler and Wendell Calder. Along with them, we've got a number of missionaries who are going to be with us and musicians. I want to tell you, I think this is going to be the best conference we've had in a long, long time. Now remember, it starts here at this church on July 31st at 6 in the evening, and then Monday through Friday at the casino at Lakemont Park at 7 o'clock in the evening, also at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And if you come to at least one of those services, you get a complimentary meal. And I'll tell you what, they give us a good meal out there. But we'd invite you all to come. If you'd like to have a brochure on the conference, contact us here at the church, and we will be delighted to send one your way. But that's July 31st, starting at 6 o'clock, and then Monday through Friday at 4 in the afternoon and at 7 o'clock in the evening out at the casino at Lakemont Park. A great time coming our way, and we invite you to be a part of it. You know, the Word of God is rich, and every time you read it, it just comes alive. Yesterday, we had the opportunity, Nancy and I, of having a couple of our grandchildren at our house, and Saturday, among other things, is car wash day for me. And I took one of my grandsons, Cademan, with me to a car wash. He had never been in such a thing. And he was quite interested in watching the soap come on and the soap go off. And I mean, we were just having a good time. But en route to the car wash, he was asking me questions about how I make a sermon. He's 10 years old. But he wanted to know how long did it take me to make one, and you know, what I do to decide to have one. And he even asked me if one of my series is over. He was wanting to know if my series on spiritual growth is over. I said, oh, yeah, we ended that a long time ago. And so he said, well, what are you preaching on tomorrow? And I told him, he said, do you have any other series coming? And I said, yeah, well, perhaps I do. And we talked a little bit about that. But, you know, I said to him yesterday, I said, you know, when you open the Bible to read it, there's always something new you learn. And he said, yeah, Papa, that's right. There's always something new you learn from the Bible. Imagine from a 10-year-old boy. But that is true. When you're in the Word of God, there's always something new to learn. Psalm 138 is a psalm that I've been looking at recently, and it says, I will praise thee with my whole heart. Before the gods will I sing praise unto thee. I will worship toward thy holy temple and praise thy name for thy loving kindness and for thy truth. Listen to this. For thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name. You know, it's an amazing verse, isn't it? God has magnified his name. We know that. He protects his name. He wants to exalt his name. But then it says he puts his word even above his name. That's an amazing thing to consider. And that shows us how important it is for us to study the Word of God and to have a high respect for God's Word. And then you drop down into verse 5. It says, yea, they shall sing in the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. You know, that's why we are in this service this morning, whether you're joining us by Media Ministries or here in the sanctuary. We are here to focus on the greatness of God's glory. And so I trust that as we sing another song and listen to some special music and then open the Bible and continue our series, as Cademan would have said it, in God's amazing grace, I trust that together we will focus on the greatness of God and by the end of this service be able to say, great is the glory of the Lord. What a great God we have. And number 601 in our hymn book says, leaning on the everlasting arms. And as Christians, we can do that. We've got God's strength and provision always. So as the introduction begins, let's stand and sing number 601.
Thank you. can I say thanks for the things you have done for me? Things so undeserved that you gave to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude, all that I am and ever hope to be. I owe it all to thee. To God be the glory, to God be the glory, to God be the glory for the things He has done. For this God, He has saved me. With His power, He has raised me. To God be the glory for the things He has done. Just let me live my life. Let it be clear. Should I gain a praise, let it go to Calvary. For this God, He has saved me. With His power, He has raised me.
Thank you, Cheryl Plunkett. To God be the glory for the things He hath done. And He's done a lot for us. And that is His grace. We've been involved in a series of messages now for a while entitled God's Amazing Grace. And of course, we don't have the opportunity of looking at it every Sunday, but we do have the opportunity of looking at it from time to time. And as Cademan said to me yesterday, how long does the series go? I don't know. It goes till it's finished. And, so by the grace of God, we'll continue to study the grace of God. By the way, it's amazing what young people and grandchildren do to you. Ever think about that? Yesterday, Gabriella and Cademan made me a chocolate cake made out of dirt. And they brought it to me, and they were surprised when I took a bite of that dirt and ate it. Amazing what grandchildren would do. I just hope it was clean dirt. But that was a part of God's grace. I guess I survived it. But you know, God's grace is great, isn't it? And as I've been looking at this series myself, I keep thinking, I don't know how in the world I am going to be able to communicate to this congregation the greatness of God's grace. And, you know, even this morning as I was sitting back in the library before the service, I was reading through Ephesians chapter 2, where it talks about the exceeding riches of God's grace. God's grace is not only exceeding, but it is filled with exceeding riches. And it tells us that throughout all of eternity, we're going to be learning about God's wonderful grace. And so, you know, I'm not exactly sure how much longer we will be on this particular series, but that's okay. It was Charles Haddon Spurgeon, and today, what I'm going to do in the message is to look at some of the things that we become recipients of because of God's grace, that without the grace of God, we would not even be able to touch. But one of the things that Charles Haddon Spurgeon, by the way, has said a lot about God's grace. And one of the things that he said in one of his particular sermons was basically this. He said, if people do not like the doctrine of grace, give them more of it. And I don't think that in this congregation we have people who do not like the grace of God. I think that everybody under the sound of my voice today does like the grace of God and thanks God for His grace. But we're still going to look at more of it. Because without God's grace, we would not be saved. Without God's grace, we would not be sustained. Without God's grace, we would not be able to spend eternity with the Lord. Without God's grace, we would never get through the trials and the troubles we face in life. It's all because of the amazing grace of God. And so today, once again, I just want to read along with you the key passages that we've been looking at for the grace of God. And it's been a couple of weeks since we've read this, but I want to read it again. So I would invite you to take your copy of God's Word and turn to the book of Titus chapter 2, and then turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And in addition today, turn to Ephesians chapter 2. So Titus chapter 2, 1 Corinthians 15, and then Ephesians, the second chapter. And we'll be reading some out of each one of those chapters. And I invite you to stand out of respect for God and His Word as I read and you follow along. First of all, we'll start with Titus chapter 2, and then 1 Corinthians 15, and then Ephesians 2. Titus chapter 2, beginning with verse 11, says, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave Himself for us, that He might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto Himself a peculiar people zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee. And what we have noted when we looked at that particular passage a couple of weeks ago is that by God's grace, we have salvation. By God's grace, it has appeared to all men that all might be saved. By God's grace, we are taught how to live a godly life. By God's grace, we can anticipate Christ's return. And by God's grace, we realize that Jesus Christ went to the cross for us. Thank God for His grace. Then we turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and just one verse there, where it says in verse 10, but by the grace of God I am what I am, and His grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. I'm going to come back to that one in just a moment, so keep your finger there as you turn to Ephesians chapter 2. And I know we looked at Ephesians chapter 2 earlier, but we may even be looking at this a little bit later, because as I was going through it this morning, I was reminded of the great contrast the grace of God brings into our lives when we trust Christ as Savior. Beginning with verse 1 of Ephesians 2, the first three verses reminds us of our life before Christ. It says, and you hath He quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world. That means on your way to judgment. according to the prince of the power of this air, of the air. That means under the direction of Satan, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. What a sad condition of mankind apart from salvation. We are totally depraved, so lost we can't save ourselves. But then verse 2 says, But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace are ye saved, and hath raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show, now look at this, the exceeding riches of his grace. Say that with me. Exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. That little phrase there in verse 7, the exceeding riches of his grace, caught my attention this morning back in the library before the service, and I meditated upon that. And in reality, what that tells us is that God's grace abounds and overflows intensively with riches that we can't even comprehend. I want you to think about that. God's grace abounds and overflows in an intensified way with riches that we can't comprehend, so much so that it tells us that throughout the ages to come, we're going to be learning about it. So just a short little series has nothing to compare with the eternal study that God's going to give us on the riches of his grace. What a Savior. What grace. What grace. So let's pray, and then we'll look into the Word of God. Father, we thank you once again for the opportunity that we've had just to read your Word. And I pray now that you'll teach us your word and give us a greater appreciation of this great grace that we have from you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Turn back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. You know, we often say that 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is the resurrection chapter. And it is, because it talks about the resurrection of Christ and talks about what we can expect because of the resurrection of Christ, and that is our own resurrection as well. But look at that 10th verse. You'll see that the word grace is mentioned three times in that verse. Think about that. God's grace is so great. But look at it. For by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Who's talking here? The Apostle Paul, under the leading of the Spirit of God, indeed. But remember, he was one who wanted to wipe the world rid of Christ, wipe the world rid of the Christian movement. He thought it was, adverse to the teachings of the Old Testament Scripture. He, of course, on his way to Damascus, had an encounter with Christ. He was on his way to Damascus to kill believers, to kill Christians. But the Lord Jesus Christ met him face to face, and Paul came to Christ and became the greatest of all missionaries, the greatest of all evangelists, the greatest of all pastors, as far as I'm concerned. But notice how he describes God's grace in his life there in verse 10. He says, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. You see, Paul knew what he was before he got saved, one who was out to persecute, ridicule, destroy Christians. But he says, I am what I am now, a Christian, by God's grace. What does that little phrase teach us when it says, but by the grace of God, I am what I am? That is speaking of the fact that God's grace saves us. Now, we've talked about that over and over again, and we'll continue to talk about it. Keep in mind that we can't save ourselves, and we're going to notice a little bit later on in this morning's message that we can't even come to Jesus Christ on our own if it were not for the grace of God. And so Paul said, I am thankful that by God's grace I am what I am. That is, I am now saved. I was a heathen. I was a destroyer of the church. But now I'm saved by the grace of God. And some of you today can say, yeah, you were alcoholics. You were drug addicts. You were carousers. But now you're saved by the grace of God. And you can rejoice in that, can't you? To God be the glory. Then he says, and his grace, which bestowed upon me, was not in vain. What does this talk about? Well, this is the fact that Paul was saying that by God's grace, I am involved in serving the Lord. You know, we can't serve the Lord apart from the grace of God. And certainly, as I said a moment ago, God worked in such a way in the life of the Apostle Paul that there was none greater in establishing churches, none greater in laying the foundation of the Christian doctrine, none greater in teaching young pastors such as Timothy in the things of the Lord. And so when Paul said, and his grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain, Paul was saying, yes, God saved me by his grace, but he enabled me and he equipped me to serve him by his grace. And so you see, no matter what it is God calls us to do, he, by his grace, gives us the strength to do it. Do you understand that? When he calls you to be a missionary, when he calls you to be a pastor, or when he calls you to clean the toilet at the church, it's by God's grace that you can do it, because God's grace is that which indeed does enable us for service. And then Paul goes on, and he said, but I labored more abundantly than they all, talking about the fact, he says, I did more work than those other disciples. And you know, when you read about him, I guess you could say that he did. And he did, or it wouldn't say that right here. Because the Word of God is always accurate and true. Amen. But he goes on and he says, yet not I. He says, yes, I labored more abundantly, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. He said, yes, I was able to do a lot of things for the cause of Christ, but it was not me. It was the grace of God that enabled me to do it, which means this third time the word grace is mentioned in this verse, Paul was saying that it's God's grace that sustained me to do what he wanted me to do. I tell you today, and I don't want us ever to forget it, that without the grace of God, we would be eternally lost. But by the grace of God, we are saved. By the grace of God, we serve. And by the grace of God, we are sustained. You take the grace of God out of the picture, ladies and gentlemen, you have nothing. You understand that? You take the grace of God out of the picture, you have nothing. Everything that we have, everything that we are, everything that we determine to be, everything that we will be for now and throughout all of eternity is all because of the grace of God. That's why we need to sing Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. Thank God for his amazing grace. Well, having said that, what I want us to do today, and you know we've come a long way, we've discussed a lot about God's grace. I want to share a little bit with you about the work of God's grace that has been presented to mankind. And keep in mind that when we're talking about the grace of God, we're talking about the fact that God bent over backwards to provide for us a salvation that we do not deserve. He literally stooped down. He condescended upon us with great favor that we might be saved and that we might be able to serve him and that we might be able to be sustained as his children. I mentioned a couple of weeks ago that Charles Swindoll gave this particular definition of God's grace that I think is good. Charles Swindoll said, the grace is what God does for mankind, which we do not deserve, which we cannot earn, and which we never will be able to repay. Now stop to think about that for a minute. I mean, that's a good definition that comes from the Hebrew and the Greek word for grace. But think of it again. Grace is what God does for mankind, that means all of us, which we do not deserve, which we cannot earn, can't work for it, and which we never will be able to repay. Oh, thank God for His grace. Are you awake this morning? You know what? There is no doubt about it, but some of us have burdens in our heart today, but can you put those burdens out in pasture for a while and think about the grace of God today? You say, why, Pastor Gary? Because it's the grace of God that's going to get you through that burden. Forget the burden for the next 28 minutes and 21 seconds and focus on the grace of God that will get you through that. What I want to do, as I said, is to share with you some of the great things that we have because of the grace of God. And these verses that I'm going to give you are not necessarily verses that talk about God's grace, but shows to us what we have because of God's grace. Are you with me? So let's turn, first of all, to Romans chapter 3. Now, the word grace is mentioned in this passage, but what we're going to find in this passage of Scripture is that because of the grace of God, the finished work of Christ on the cross has provided redemption, reconciliation, and propitiation for all who believe. That is, the finished work of Christ on the cross provided redemption, reconciliation, and propitiation for all that believe, that is, all Christians. Notice again, Romans 3, beginning with verse 23, it says, "For all have sinned and come short to the glory of God." That's every one of us. You've been born a sinner, and so have I. If you want to go to heaven, you need to have forgiveness of that sin, and it only comes through trusting Christ alone as your Savior. For by grace are ye saved. But then notice going on with verse 24, it says, being justified freely, what are those next three words? By His grace. Through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in His blood to declare His righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. Just take a look at that particular text. Because of the grace of God, we are saved, yes. But what we see there are a couple of elements of our salvation that many times we don't think about. He says, being justified freely by His grace. That word justified means to be declared not guilty with respect to our sin. Are we guilty of sin? Yes. But you see, when we come to Jesus Christ because of the grace of God, through the shed blood of Christ, God the Father declares us not guilty with respect to our sin based upon the work of Christ. That's all because of God's grace. Then He says that through the grace of God, we have redemption. The word redemption means to purchase or to pay. And when Jesus Christ died on the cross of Calvary, He paid the wage of our sin, which is what? Death. He died for us. And when He did that, He took us up out of the market of sin and set us on our tour to heaven. And it won't end until we get to heaven. And then it'll go on throughout eternity, all because of His redemptive work that's a part of God's grace. Verse 25 says, whom God has set forth to be propitiation. That word propitiation is a word that we don't use too often, but it means that the work of Jesus Christ on the cross not only paid the price of our sin, which is death, but fully satisfied the Father. You see, when Jesus Christ shed His blood, died, rose again, and went back up and sat down at the right hand of the Father, Jesus didn't say to Jesus, well, you did a pretty good job for 75% of what you did. No. He said, you have fully satisfied me on the cross. And now, all who trust Jesus Christ as Savior become recipients of that great work of Jesus Christ. And then he goes on and says, through faith that is in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past. Do you know something? Because of the grace of God and through the work of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary, all of your sins are gone. Past, present, and future. Now, that doesn't mean that we can go out and live like the devil and get away with it. Are you with me on that? We are going to stumble and fall into sin. Do we have anybody here who's not yet sinned today? I'm glad no hand is going up, because somebody has probably said a thing that shouldn't have been said or had a thought that shouldn't have been thought. We all sin, don't we? But thanks be unto God that that sin has been covered by the blood of Christ. And when we sin, we're to confess. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But the reality of it is, ladies and gentlemen, that because of the grace of God, we stand in Christ. We stand in the Beloved before God the Father. And God looks upon us and says, I don't remember that sin anymore, because it's separated as far from you as the east is from the west. That's grace. That should motivate us to live a life to please the Lord. Amen. And so you see, because of the grace of God, the work of Christ on the cross has given to us redemption and propitiation and justification and the remission of sins. Oh, we're going to sing at the end of the service today, the Lord willing, if Jesus doesn't come first. No, that's not the name of the song. But at the end of the service, we're going to sing, Grace Greater Than All My Sin. Oh, come on, you Baptists, get a grip on that. Grace Greater Than All My Sin. Secondly, the work of God's grace presented to mankind brings the conviction work of the Holy Spirit, convincing us or convicting mankind of sin. Think of that. Through the grace of God, there is the convicting work of the Holy Spirit convicting mankind of sin. Turn with me, if you would please, back to the Gospel of John chapter 16. John chapter 16, the Lord Jesus is basically talking about the ministry of the Holy Spirit. He is actually preparing his disciples for the fact that he is soon going to go to the cross and on that cross suffer and bleed and die and resurrect from the grave 3 days later to provide salvation for us. But notice what he says in John chapter 16, verse 7, beginning with verse 7. He says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth. And by the way, Jesus Christ is truth. All truth stems from Christ. There is no truth apart from Christ. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you, the Comforter being the Holy Spirit. But if I depart, I will send him unto you, and when he is come, he, that is the Holy Spirit, will reprove or convict. That the word reprove means convict. Will reprove, convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin because they believe not on me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and ye see me no more. Of judgment, because the prince of this world, that is Satan, is judged. Jesus was laying out here a tremendous ministry of the Holy Spirit. And he says, when the Spirit of God comes, and of course, the Spirit of God was in the world in the Old Testament, but he had a different type of a ministry in the Old Testament than he does now in New Testament days. And so Jesus was saying, I'm telling you something, I'm telling you the truth, that when the Spirit of God comes, there are at least three things he's going to do. Number one, he's going to convict the world of sin, and secondly, of righteousness and of judgment. What does that mean? Well, when he says he's going to convict the world of sin, what Jesus was saying is that he is going to show everybody in the world that they are sinners and need the Savior. Now, I'm going to come back to that. Then he says he's going to convict the world of righteousness. And by that, Jesus means this: it's the Spirit of God who's going to teach the world what righteousness is all about. And then he says in verse 11, of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged. In other words, Jesus was saying the Spirit of God is going to teach us, is going to teach you what judgment is all about, even the judgment of the prince of the world himself, including Satan. But let's go back to that first phrase there in verse 9, where he says of sin, because they believed not on me. Now, everybody look at me for just a minute. You could never save yourself. In fact, you would never know that you needed to be saved if the Spirit of God did not convict you of your sin of unbelief. Every now and then people come along and say, well, I just got saved one day. Well, yeah, you know, maybe so. But you wouldn't know that you needed salvation. You wouldn't know that you needed Christ. You wouldn't know that you needed forgiveness of sin if the Spirit of God, first of all, did not come upon you in some way, shape, or form and convince you of your sin of unbelief and say to you, as the Spirit of God speaks through that still small voice, you need a Savior, and Jesus is that Savior. Apart from the grace of God, we would not even know that we are sinners and need to be born again. Sometimes the Spirit of God teaches us through the preaching of the Word of God, just like this we're doing here this morning. Sometimes the Spirit of God convicts us as we read the Word of God ourselves. But it's the Spirit of God who takes the Word of God and shows everybody who has ever been or whoever will be saved that they need the Savior. And without the grace of God, that conviction would never come. So you see, it's because of the grace of God that the finished work of Christ, providing redemption, reconciliation, propitiation, and the forgiveness of sins, comes our way. It's because of the grace of God that we have the convicting work of the Spirit of God convicting us of sin. Ladies and gentlemen, we ought to be thankful for the amazing grace of God. If Jesus doesn't come first, before the end of this service, at the end of this service, we're going to sing that song, Marvelous Grace of Our Loving Lord. Grace, grace, God's grace. Are you thankful for God's grace? Charles Spurgeon, we have a Spurgeon scholar in our church. His name's Pat, and he walks around a lot. Charles Spurgeon said this about God's grace. He says, if heaven were by merit, it would never be heaven to me. For if I were in it, I should say, I'm not sure I'm here. I'm sure I'm here by mistake. I'm sure this is not my place because I have no claim to it. But if it be of grace and not of works, then we may walk into heaven with boldness. What was Spurgeon saying? He was saying that basically if it's by my works I got into heaven, I look around and say, I don't belong here. But because of the grace of God, I do belong here through faith in Christ. Thank God for his grace. Spurgeon also said, observe the rain which drops from heaven. It falls on the desert as well as on the fertile field. It drops on the rock that will refuse its fertilizing moisture as well as on the soil that opens its gaping mouth to drink it in with gratitude. It falls on the streets of the city where it is not even required and where men will even curse it for coming. And it falls more freely where the sweet flowers have been panting for it and the withering leaves have been rustling forth their prayers. But such is the grace of God. It does not visit us because we ask for it, much less because we deserve it, but as God wills it. You see, what Spurgeon was saying is that God's grace does not come because we ask for it. God's grace does not come because we deserve it, but God's grace pours out upon us because God says, I'm going to shower you with my grace. And my grace is sufficient to save you, to enable you to serve me, and to sustain you, not only for life, but for all of eternity. And so by the grace of God, the convicting work of the Spirit of God is conducted. Thirdly, it's the saving work of God that delivers the believers from sin, all because of God's grace. Turn with me, if you would please, to Romans chapter 4 and note verse 25. Again, we're going to find that the word grace is not mentioned here, but the concept is that without the grace of God, we would not experience what this text tells us. Romans chapter 4, beginning with verse 23, where it says, "Now it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but for us also, to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead," it's talking about Jesus, "who," what? "Was delivered for our offenses," our sins. "Jesus was delivered by God the Father into the world for our sins and was raised up again for our justification." And of course, you know that word justification, some people describe as being just as if I've never sinned. You've heard that before. But it means more than that, because we have sinned. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But justification simply means this, that based upon the work of Jesus Christ on the cross, his shed blood, his sinless, totally perfect sacrifice, when a person calls upon the name of the Lord, God says in reference to that person, "I declare you not guilty with respect to your sin." Think of that. I declare you not guilty with respect to your sin based upon the work of Christ. And that's all because of God's grace. Ladies and gentlemen, without the grace of God, we would not know of the work of Christ on the cross. Without the grace of God, we would not know that we were sinners and needed to be saved. Without the grace of God, we would not be delivered from our sin. But through the grace of God, we have it all. Are you getting the point? Am I getting the point? We don't need to have the word grace in this verse to tell us that without the grace of God, Jesus Christ would not have been delivered. We don't need the word grace in this verse to tell us that without the grace of God, Jesus wouldn't have risen from the grave. We don't need the word grace in here to teach us that it's because of God's grace that we're justified. It's all because of God's grace. Grace, grace, God's grace. The Lord Jesus does not come within the 11 minutes and 37 seconds left of this service, we're going to sing that great song of God's grace in a few minutes. Thank God for his grace by which we are justified. Again, Spurgeon said this. He said, "I hear someone murmur, 'God will not give grace to men who do not repent.'" Spurgeon says, "God gives men grace to repent. And no man ever repents till grace first is given him to lead him to repentance." Somebody else says, "But God will not give his grace to those who won't believe." But Spurgeon says, I reply, "God gives grace to men by which they are moved to believe. It is through the grace of God that they are brought to faith in Christ." How do you know that you need to repent from your sin and trust Christ? God's grace. How do you know that you need to be born again? By God's grace. You know, we ought to make ours our theme song, "The Wonderful Grace of Jesus." Because without it, we would have no relationship at all with our God. Well, the finished work of Christ on the cross is because of his grace. The convicting work of the Holy Spirit is because of his grace. The saving work of God delivering us from sin is because of his grace. But you know what? The keeping work of God that gives us eternal security is because of his grace. Aren't you glad that you will never, ever lose your salvation? Aren't you glad that you never, ever will lose your salvation? You know, we don't work for our salvation. It's by God's grace. And we don't have to work to keep our salvation. It's by God's grace. And again, that doesn't give us the license to sin. It should give us the encouragement to live for the Lord more. But turn with me, if you would please, to the book of 1 Peter. 1 Peter in chapter 1. Again, these are verses or passages of Scripture that do not necessarily mention the word grace, but the point is, nevertheless, in those passages, that without grace, we would not have these things. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His what? Abundant mercy." By the way, mercy is grace's twin, right? You see, God's grace is that God does not give us what we deserve. And God's mercy is the fact that God gives us what we don't deserve, which is heaven. He says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively," or a living hope. Do you have a lively hope today? You know, the world, listen, the world is going to hell in a handbasket, isn't it? We see that every day when we read the news or watch the news or whatever we do to get the news. The world is a mess. But those of us who know Jesus Christ have a living hope. That's why I often say, keep looking up, because what? The best is yet to come. Because of the living hope that we have in Christ by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Here it is, to an inheritance, incorruptible, can't be corrupted, undefiled, can't be made filthy, that fadeth not away, it will not end, reserved in heaven for you, it's there now, who are kept by the power of God. And you can write there in your Bibles, if you want, in the margin, that when he says, who are kept by the power of God, that's God's grace. Because you see, without God's grace, we would not be able to keep our salvation ourselves. But with the grace of God, we are eternally secure. Ladies and gentlemen, no grace, no eternal security. But thank God for his grace that gives us eternal security. Because we are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation. Look at this. Ready. 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 Ready to go to heaven. Ready to be revealed in the last time. You know, when we die and stand before the Lord, we're not going to have to do, as somebody said years ago, plead our case before God. When Jesus Christ died at the cross of Calvary and shed his blood, the case was settled. And when we die and stand before God, it's not going to be St. Peter there at the gate. Those of you who think that, you need to read your Bible. St. Peter will not be the one I'm looking for. But when we die and stand before heaven's gate, there the Lord Jesus Christ will say, "Welcome home, my child." All because of God's grace. Because you see, we're kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed. That inheritance God has is ready to be given to us. That inheritance that God has for us is ready for us to receive. And it's all because of the amazing grace of Almighty God. Thank God for his grace. Charles Spurgeon said, "An old friend said to me yesterday," 150 years ago at least, Charles Spurgeon's dead, but an old friend said to Spurgeon when he was writing this yesterday, "Nothing will do for you and me but grace." I, Charles Spurgeon said to him, "Yes, and even that won't do unless it's the grace of God. It must be God's own grace or else we never can be saved." Oh, you Baptists, you who are not Baptists, what do you think of the wonderful grace of God? Amazing. It's the wonderful grace of God that has saved us. It's the wonderful grace of God that enables us to serve the Lord And it's the wonderful grace of God that sustains us. If Jesus does not come in the next 4 minutes and 20 seconds, 35 seconds, whatever, we're going to sing a great song in God's grace and we'll want to lift it up. But I ask you this morning, have you applied God's grace to your life? For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. If you want to go to heaven, you must receive God's grace and trust Jesus Christ as your Savior. Call upon His name and be saved. And then every moment of every day, thank God for His grace, by which you serve, by which you are sustained for all of eternity. Fall in love with God's grace. Because falling in love with God's grace means that you'll be falling in love with God Himself. Grace, grace, God's wonderful grace. Let's not take it for granted. Let's stand for prayer. Father in heaven, as we come to you this morning, I thank you for the opportunity that we've had to look into your word. Lord, there's no way that this poor humble preacher can even touch the tip of the iceberg on the greatness of your grace. But I do pray that your Spirit will teach us somewhat of your grace today that will cause us to leave this place today with a different attitude towards life. It's by your grace that we can face anything we face. And Lord, if there's anybody under the sound of my voice who has not yet been saved, they've not yet been born again, they've not yet trusted Christ, it's my prayer that today they'll call upon the name of the Lord Jesus and be saved, in whose name I pray. Amen. Well, I think for our final hymn, we might sing number 345, Grace Greater Than All of Our Sin. If you're here today and you have a spiritual need, this altar is open for you. Please come and we'll be delighted to talk to you about the Lord. And if you're joining us by Media Ministries and God has spoken to your heart, we would love to talk to you about your walk with the Lord too. So contact us as we sing number 345, Grace Greater Than Our Sin.
From the sanctuary of Faith Baptist Church, Altoona, Pennsylvania, 315 40th Street in the Highland Park section of the city, Dr. Gary G. Dell and the Family of Faith welcomes you to Sunday school at 9:30, morning worship 10:30, Sunday night service at 6, with youth programs and adult prayer and Bible study Wednesday at 7,
with Kids for Truth every Wednesday night at 6:30 during the school year.
If we may ever be of further spiritual help to you, please call 814-944-2894. Log on to our website, www.fbcaltoona.org, or write to the Faith Baptist Church at 315 40th Street, Altoona, Pennsylvania, 16602, USA. Till the next time we meet, may our Lord richly bless you as you serve Him.